might want to get...
I served my time as a carpenter in a neighboring parish. I'd always been keen to go fishing. When the opportunity came along, that's what I did. I changed from carpentering to fishing. But lifeboat work, ever since I finished my national service, giving my age away now, but ever since I finished my national service, I've been in the lifeboat crew. Lifeboat came to Sennen to start with in 1853. Well, you can see from the picture, they're a pretty hard-looking crowd. They'd all been fishermen. Quite common years ago to have boats founder, because if they got caught out in a gale or the weather turned foggy or anything, they didn't have engines and these are sort of navigational aids that you've got today. It was all on a compass course, dead reckoning, and if the tide was foul, they had to anchor up. The lifeboats of yesterday were pulling rowing boats. Then they improved them with sailing as well. Then they went to the first motor lifeboats in the early 1900s. They, years ago, used to drive the boat out with a team of horses, pulling it. And they would go down and launch the boat into the water from the carriage. And to do that, the horses would have to go out into the water and then turn the carriage with the boat facing the sea. Everybody used to turn out, and perhaps the men would have been away working during the day. If the men were at the fishing and there wasn't a number of them left to do it, then the women would turn to and do the job.
First time I went out was exercise. Only a young lad, 23. Still the same amount of keenness to go, and the local parish community, they you know, they're all keen to support it. I don't know why we put a lifeboat at Sennen. I take it that years ago it was about the only place within a few miles that you could launch any kind of rescue craft. It had a beach. And I suppose the simple geography of the place. It's nearly out at Land's End Point. It's only a mile from Land's End. The Cornish coast is the main hazard. It's a bit notorious. It's claimed a lot of lives over the years. Even in recent years, it's claimed lives.
Gerald.
Hi, Mike.
Got that sail ready for me?
Yes, all ready for you.
Oh, here it is.
Take a good hold of it because I haven't tidied up.
Just go and put it on board.
Yeah.
Get the boats in the pump.
Oh, don't stay there too long.
Oh, well.
Cheerio.
Well, I keep my boat in Malden, which is on the east coast, Essex, only about 40 miles from London, I suppose. it's a nice place to keep a boat. The only drawback is that it's tidal, so you can only move the boat a couple of hours before high water, and got to get about 5 miles down the river before you've got enough water to stay afloat. It's quite an old port. I think it's one of the favourite places for the Vikings to raid. No, it's mainly used by yachtsmen. The people I'm sailing with this weekend, we generally meet in the pub and work out what we're doing. We've got to leave it on the tide, otherwise it'll be left here high and dry.
So where are we going to go?
So how about going up here to Fambridge and that nice yacht harbour up there?
Well, the basic thing is, that, I mean, it doesn't really matter where we go as long as we don't go northeast against this wind.
No, I think that's very sensible.
And can we get through here, or have we got to go round?
Now, if you want to go up there, it's going to be a hard old punch all the way.
We haven't got a lot of time. It's high tide in an hour.
Mm. So what do you think, Mike? Where do you fancy going?
I fancy the coast myself.
Yeah, that's a great boat. Ferry boat. Okay. In, out, through the spitway.
Fine.
Once we've got the boat provisioned, we've just got to leave Molden. Another couple of hours to be aground. It's stuck there for a tide, so we've got to get down the river and anchor off for the evening. And we're ready for what the day's got to offer when we wake up. Where we'll go, it all depends on what the weather forecast is. Obviously, if it's bad, we won't go too far, although they're both good boats. This time of the year, you've got to watch the weather. We know the days will be short, but often you get very strong winds. Stay in the river, you're all right. You can't come to much harm there, but if you want to go further afield, it's all depending on what the forecasts are. You don't want to provide any work for the lifeboats.
Present crew live in Sennen, but they're not all Sennen people by birth. We've got, I think, about three what I call foreigners, and the rest are local born. But we've got, I think, it's about 18 men on this station. That's the minimum number we can work with here, you know. It takes that number of men to do the handling. Today we draw crew from all walks of life, but years ago it was mainly the fishing community that provided the lifeboat service. We've got a couple of fishermen in the crew. I got a builder. I got one chap works for the county council on the roads. Another chap's a motor mechanic. We used to have a couple of blokes who worked on the farm.
Right, that's exercise this morning with a helicopter. And I'll just read out those who are going to form the crew today.
They all have to be able to work with each other without question, do as they're asked. I mean, they do it. That is the beauty of it all, that a man who goes to sea in a lifeboat, if you ask him to do something or tell him to do something, then it's done to the best of his ability. There's no question that he will question the order or the request. He will just carry it out.
Let go, Jack.
helicopters do a tremendous job of work. A certain amount of leg pulling goes on amongst the crews, who can be top dog, naturally. But rivalry at sea, no. When we're on the job, we're complementing each other. And they can quite often get to a scene of a casualty much, much quicker than a lifeboat, and maybe save life because of that. Of winching off people from a ship is to lower your winchman, or your diver, as they call him, down on the end of the wire, and he contacts the survivors and straps them into a strop one at a time and hoists them up. In the case of a vessel which is moving violently around, that man himself is taking a tremendous risk. And this is where the lifeboat can come into its own, because it's got to be really bad before you can't approach close enough to catch somebody off the vessel. And if you've got a life jacket on, well then hopefully you can be picked up within a very short space of time.
Great attraction is that you have the place to yourself. You see, look round, no one about. Come round here in the summer, it's absolutely crowded, you know, stiff with boats. I mean, the drawbacks, obviously, it's a bit cold, but, you know, you don't mind putting up with that. Well, my first boat was an impulse buy. I lived in a derelict cottage, and we'd saved up enough money to have a kitchen built on. And the money was in the bank, and I saw this boat for sale, and I bought it. And my wife told me years later that for a fortnight she never spoke to me. And I was so excited about this boat that I never noticed.
Well, the odd thing about a boat, you can never relax. And the best thing that ever happened to me was early on I had a good scare when I nearly lost a boat, nearly lost my life. The sails blew out, so with no motive power. The engine I had was 5 horse, which in the conditions that were prevailing at the time, it wasn't enough. So we was just drifting, and a boat came alongside to pick us up, and it hit us so hard it opened up the hull and it started sinking. So we was lucky to get off, my wife, 2 small children. Once you've had an experience like that, you never take chances. You always listen to the weather forecast, look after your gear and the boat and things like that. But that's 20-odd years ago now, and touch wood, that's the only accident I've ever had. And I'm pretty sure it's because after an experience like that, you realise that you can't take chances with the sea.
Very nice.
You soon get to know the boats that are out all through the winter, like Tom. I mean, I've seen him about for years. You recognise the boats, you recognise them, you get friendly with them, you see them in the pub when you get back, and I thought it was a sort of mutual insurance, actually. You see your friends about, you know you've got somebody there, especially this time of year when there's not many boats about.
Variable 2 or 3 becoming northeasterly 5. Showers later, good. Thames, Dover. Northerly 6, occasionally gale 8 for a time. Wintry showers, good.
The forecast isn't too good this weekend, but fortunately in this part of the world, no matter from where it blows from, you can generally find some shelter. We'll have a comfortable night, all right, I'm pretty sure of that. And we've got plenty of fish to get through and catch the early morning tide back to Malden.
We've got a crew or a team of chaps who feel, well, this is the thing I want to do to be a good citizen, if you like. And, you know, it's like part-time firemen. They're willing to risk their necks. For what? Oh, why do people climb mountains? Because it's there, you know. A lifeboat is there, it's got to be manned, so they feel that they can do something about that. People like that, they're the backbone of it all.
You can take a boat, you can go to sea. But why shouldn't you? We're supposed to be in a free society. Because a lifeboat man responds to a call, that's entirely up to him. That is his freedom of choice. Same as it is any man who sails a yacht. It's his freedom of choice. And I would hate to see anything different in that respect. Wintertime, you do expect at the back of your mind is that thought, well, we're likely to have a call, but you don't get them more often in the winter than you do in the summer. You can't put an average on anything like that. It's like an undertaker's business, you know. People can die at any time. You don't get them regular.
Most people have a sort of regular routine, and sailing gets you out of it. When you come sailing, you haven't a clue what's going to happen during a normal sailing day. Whereas normally at home, people know what time they're going to breakfast, what they're going to have for breakfast, what time lunch is. Once you get on a boat, it's all to do with wind and weather and tide and things like that.
Most excellent fish this has done it.
The salts of it.
The most beautiful fish.
How many did you get aboard in the end?
Three.
And we've only eaten one so far.
Oh, well, I'm going to eat me of it.
Peter, that looks a bit low.
It is a bit low. I must confess, there's not too much in there. Thank you very much.
There are warnings of gales in Viking and Finisterre. The general synopsis at 1200.
When you make the decision to go, the lifeboat is called out and you see the conditions that may be pretty bad. A lot of lads have got young kids, young wives. Well, you know, is it tonight or isn't it? But they go, and that's all part of the scheme of things. They are still willing to take that amount of risk.
they're all keen, I suppose, maybe something to do with the, I wouldn't say glamour of the job, but it's a sort of worthwhile thing to do. Glamour is the wrong word, really, because it's not at all glamorous in actual operation of a lifeboat. It's a bit of a pain, you know, I mean, you can get pretty sore out there, and get pretty seasick as well sometimes. Then it's not pretty, you know, you get sometimes you go out and you bring bodies in, rather than survivors. There's not much glamour in that. It's a bit sort of hairy if the weather's bad. People don't see that side of it. All they see is the lifeboat on the slip, big splash when it enters the water, lights flashing, maroons going off, etc. But it's got an appeal anyway, you know, lifeboats always have. Keeper at the Pendine lighthouse reported this sort of intermittent flashing light. Shouldn't have been any vessel there. I mean, he was much too close in for safety, and he wasn't sure of it. So when you get a doubt like this, then you have to take the cautious side and you go and investigate. As it turned out, night like that, bit of a sea on and a gale of wind, we had to punch our way up through there. Well, pretty nasty at times. And we got up there, and all it was one of these fishermen's dans with a winky light on the top.
Here's the thing we got sent out for, isn't it?
It was one of those things that we get called for, which are completely unnecessary, but at the same time you have to make sure that it isn't some poor individual up there hanging on to his lantern and hoping that you'll come, you know.
Yeah, you flash,
huh? As long as I sail and I get the cartoon ideas, each one helps the other. The more I sail, the more ideas I get, the more ideas I get, the more time I have for sailing.
Invariably, every weekend, I get a few ideas which I can use, and if I don't make notes of them, I can start putting them down on the board while they're fresh in my mind. If ever the emotions are running very high or very low, when you come back to normal and think around those incidents, that's when you generally get an idea. A case in point, we passed a fishing boat. I mean, we was fairly distant off this fishing boat, but nevertheless, you just sort of visualise, if you had been close enough, that your boom would have hit him, you see? I mean, it's true, and yet, if you just push the truth or push the two boats close together, you've got a cartoon idea. It's as simple as that, really. Why sailing makes a good sort of ground for cartoons, it's obvious, really. You're so close to doom and disaster when you're sailing, and this is what cartoons are about. I mean, it's no good if everything's humdrum, it's going along on an even keel. Cartoons are the ups and downs of life, and there's a hell of a lot of ups and downs in life and sailing. If you analyse most of my cartoons, they're not really funny. I mean, they're always about boats going aground and sinking and storms and sails being blown out. Well, for some reason, the yachtsmen seem to like laughing at themselves. Lucky for me. I must admit, many times when I've got these cartoon ideas, I wasn't laughing when they were happening. It's only later.